The signs are up again at Three Rivers Stadium as a wave of fan exuberance signals the start of the 1973 season for the Pittsburgh Steelers. The enthusiasm is a carryover from 1972, when the Steelers won the first division title in their 40-year history. It was a glorious year, but they enter the new season with a new challenge, for one successful campaign does not establish a new era of winning. This, then, is the guide on for the 1973 Pittsburgh Steelers to continue their newfound winning ways during their first season as a defending champion. Steeler head coach Chuck Knoll is fully aware that a division title brings with it a curse, for it almost always brings out an opponent's best. But he's also aware that he has the men to successfully face such a test. And during the first 4 weeks of the new season, the Steelers are quite possibly the best team in pro football. In week one against Detroit, Terry Bradshaw throws touchdown passes to Ron Chanklin and John McMakin as the Steeler offense highballs to 24 points.
Last week, for the first time in their history, the Pittsburgh Steelers entered a new season as a reigning champion. Without Franco Harris, Terry Bradshaw showed his arm more often than in the past, and Detroit's Lim Barney was waiting. Three times the Lions' Greg Landry fell into the same trap, twice near the Steeler goal line. After a sluggish first half, Terry Bradshaw finally brought some life to the Steeler attack early in the third quarter. A 5.5-minute drive culminated in Bradshaw's sneak unique. Temporarily, Pittsburgh led by a comfortable 10-0 score, but just 1 minute later, Greg Landry found a quicker route to the end zone. Four yards later, Ron Jesse put the ball down. After three quarters, it was tied at 10. But early in the fourth quarter, Bradshaw and tight end John McMakin untied it spectacularly. McMakin's clutch catch put the Steelers up by 7, and with time running out, the Lions were forced into desperation measures. Lim Barney's run from punt formation failed. Bradshaw added some frosting with a touchdown to Ron Shanklin, and the rugged Steelers now haven't lost at home since season before last.
Against Cleveland the next week, a four-pronged land-based attack of Bradshaw, John Fuqua, Preston Pearson, and Steve Davis buries the Browns. Girella kicks 4 field goals and is on his way to becoming the American Conference scoring champion in 1973. Frank Lewis catches 2 touchdown passes, one from Terry Bradshaw, one from Terry Hanratty, and the Steelers crunch Cleveland with 33 points. Knoll's defense is equally impressive, yielding just 11 points per game. Detroit is dashed on the rocks of the Steeler defense with 10 points. Against Cleveland, Ernie Holmes, Joe Green, Dwight White, and L.C. Greenwood wash over Mike Phipps. Linebackers Andy Russell, Henry Davis, and Jack Ham jam the Cleveland running game, and the Browns leave town without scoring a touchdown.
In Pittsburgh, Three Rivers Stadium was packed with its usual assortment of fanatics as those bitterest of rivals, the Browns and the Steelers, went head-to-head. From the opening kickoff to the final gun on this beautiful spring-like afternoon, a supposedly much improved Cleveland team knew nothing but frustration. One big reason for the improvement was to be number 34, rookie running back Greg Pruitt, who was playing in his first regular NFL game and looked it. Pruitt's botchery was matched only by Pittsburgh's, as referee Tommy Bell ruled the play a touchback for Cleveland, not a touchdown for Pittsburgh. But it mattered little, for as everyone knows in Pittsburgh, the defense is pure gold, although L.C. Greenwood, number 68, may have gotten carried away with that assessment. Cleveland's running attack was completely shut off. And when Mike Phipps had time to throw, which was seldom, the steel curtain descended. Pittsburgh, who last year led the entire NFL in thefts, intercepted three passes for the second straight week. What's more, they kept intact their streak of holding the Browns without a single touchdown in all four games played in Three Rivers Stadium. The Steelers were almost as awesome on offense. Roy Girella kicked four field goals, and number 43, Frank Lewis, caught two touchdowns, the first from Terry Bradshaw, the second from Terry Hanratty, as last year's Central Division champions dominated the team they must beat to repeat, 33-6. If it seemed that head coach Chuck Noll was using great self-discipline and squelching a smile, it must be remembered these teams meet again in November. That will be in Cleveland, where the Steelers have been unable to win for the past 8 years.
The next week in Houston, the Steelers spoiled the Oilers with 36 more points. In Houston, the Pittsburgh defense outscores the Oilers offense. 2 touchdowns to 1. Andy Russell scores the first touchdown of his career, and Glenn Edwards returns another interception, 86 yards. Edwards and defensive backmates Mike Wagner, Mel Blunt, and number one draft pick James Thomas spearhead a ball-hawking Steeler defense that would intercept 37 passes in 1973, 11 more than any other team in pro football.
When he has pass protection, Dan Pastorini ranks behind no other quarterback in the league in pure passing ability. But unfortunately for the Houston Oilers, pass protection isn't one of their strong points, especially against Joe Green and the Pittsburgh Steelers. However, the Oilers gave the rugged Steel gang all they wanted in last Sunday's first half. John Charles' interception of a Terry Bradshaw aerial set up Houston's only score. Pastorini used a play-action pass for the touchdown. Tight end Mac Alston was on the receiving end of the Pastorini spiral, giving Houston a 7-6 halftime lead. But for the second half, the Pittsburgh defense would rule the roost. Houston's hope of a second-half ground attack faded as the steel door snapped shut. While shutting off the running game, number 68, L.C. Greenwood, led the assault on the almost non-existent Houston pass protection.
Number
Shaken by the heavy rush, Pastorini missed fire. Andy Russell followed a wave of blockers in for the Pittsburgh touchdown. The steel curtain descended again, this time on Oilers second-team quarterback Lynn Dickey. Lynn Edwards outraced the entire Houston team for an 86-yard touchdown. While the Pittsburgh defense proved too tough to handle, Terry Bradshaw was chipping away at the Oilers' secondary. A Bradshaw sneak, three Roy Girella field goals, and a touchdown pass to Ronnie Shanklin rounded out the Pittsburgh onslaught. Pittsburgh is now 3-0, while the unfortunate Oilers have dropped to 0-3.
The go in the Pittsburgh attack emanates from a super stock stable of linemen. Guards Sam Davis and Bruce Van Dyke. Tackles John Cole, Jerry Mullins, Mel Holmes, Glenn Ray Hines, and Gordon Gravel. And centers Ray Mansfield and Jim Clack. In week four against the Chargers, these mammoth men of the pit tear open the San Diego defense. Downfield, the Steeler receivers pick up blocks, and the Pittsburgh runners gorge themselves. Terry Bradshaw gets all the time he needs, and the Chargers are cracked open for 38 points as the Steelers complete their first four encounters, averaging 33 points per game. In week four, the steel curtain descends on the San Diego pass pocket and sends Johnny Unitas and the Chargers reeling. The Chargers do not score a point until the Steelers have put 38 on the board. The special teams are the final facet of this overpowering football team. They are the John Dockerys, Ed Bradleys, Rocky Blyers, and Larry Browns. Players who do not get headlines, but players who make the Pittsburgh Steelers a total team. After 4 weeks, the Steelers are the conference's only undefeated team. And with the AFC's highest scoring offense and stingiest defense, Chuck Knoll's Steelers are beginning to look like the NFL's best.
For Pittsburgh Steeler fans, 1973 is to be the year of the Steel Gang. After three decisive wins over Detroit, Cleveland, and Houston, Pittsburgh backers were using every possible device to see if indeed the Steelers are for real. San Diego found out early, the men of steel are for real. Ron Shanklin's 12-yard reception of a Terry Bradshaw aerial climaxed Pittsburgh's first possession. After two touchdowns and a field goal with Terry Bradshaw at the controls, Terry Hanratty took charge of the Steeler offensive machine, giving to number 26 Preston Pearson. We'll be right back. Pearson's 47-yard gallop made him the leading Steeler rusher with 64 yards. Henratty had only two completions for the afternoon, but one sailed for a 37-yard touchdown to Ron Shanklin. Shanklin's second reception of the half set the stage for a typically tough Pittsburgh defense. Number 29, John Dockery, blocked the punt, which Mike Wagner recovered in the end zone for a Pittsburgh touchdown and a 38-0 halftime lead. The Steelers let the hammer down on Charger quarterback Johnny Unitas, forcing a wobbly pass, which Mike Wagner picked off. A repeat of the play shows Unitas being sandwiched between Joe Green and Craig Hanneman, forcing the misfire. For John Unitas, his first pro game played in Pittsburgh wasn't one to remember, as the great veteran suffered two interceptions while completing 2 of 9 for 19 yards. The Chargers went to second-team quarterback Wayne Clark, but the Steel Gang was not impressed. The Chargers managed a fourth quarter comeback with third team quarterback Dan Fouts facing the Pittsburgh reserves. The rookie from Oregon rang up 174 yards in the air while leading the Chargers to a 21-point fourth period. Jerry Levias' reception for the touch wasn't enough, as it was all Pittsburgh to a 38-21 score.
In Cincinnati, the Steelers lose their first game of the season. The offense suddenly dries up, and Preston Pearson's touchdown is Pittsburgh's only score. Horst Mühlmann's four field goals lead the Bengals to a 19-7 victory.
The fourth quarter, Terry Bradshaw hit Ron Shanklin on a pass which was tipped by Cincinnati's Bernard Jackson. Shanklin carried to the Bengals' 6-yard line, and with the help of a penalty, 5 plays later, Preston Pearson popped over for a Pittsburgh score. But time had run out on the Pittsburgh Steelers' win streak, and the AFC Central was once again a three-dog fight as Cincinnati posted a crucial 19-7 victory over the Pittsburgh Steelers.
The Joe Namath-less Jets give the Steelers a scare the next week. Heads-up play by the defense and 4 Jarella field goals keep the Steelers in the game. But in the fourth quarter, Pittsburgh trails 14-12. With 10 minutes left in the game, Terry Hanratty's pass to Ron Shanklin finally pulls Pittsburgh ahead. The Steelers weather a stormy sea, but the next week their dream ship is nearly swamped.
The signs in Pittsburgh seemed to be a little premature last Sunday as the New York Jets' defense came with larceny in their hearts. Terry Bradshaw rifled one pass direct to number 22, Burgess Owens. The first-year man brought it into scoring range. From the 28, Jets quarterback Bill Demery hit Richard Castor, whose touchdown coupled with an early New York score made it 14-6, Jets. upset time. But then Steeler pride came alive, and even Joe Namath must have been glad he was on the sidelines. The Steelers' defense pressured Demery out of the pocket and tracked him relentlessly. Then Steeler offensive pride came to the fore as a healthy Franco Harris took off for 102 yards, and it was 1972 all over again. Then it was another man from the past, number 5, Terry Hanratty, whose pass to Ron Shanklin seemingly salted the win away. However, the Jets weren't about to lay down as number 26, Margene Adkins, came up with an extra effort return. But in the end, Bill Demery was done in by Steeler pride in the form of number 23, Mike Wagner. His interception and return set up a 2-yard Franco Harris score, which made the final score 26-14 in favor of the Steel Gang and their iron pride.
Terry Bradshaw is lost for 4 weeks. But for the third time this season, Terry Hanratty makes his first pass a touchdown pass. But Pittsburgh's joy is short-lived as disaster strikes once more. Incensed at losing two quarterbacks, the Steelers' special team pours through. The play sets up a clinching touchdown, and 3 Mike Wagner interceptions seal Pittsburgh's 6th win of the year. With 8 interceptions, Wagner ties for the league lead in interceptions in 1973. His play is characteristic of the Steeler defense.
Just 2 games ago, the Bengals had shut down Terry Bradshaw on the Steeler offense in a 19-7 victory. And in the first half of their return match, Cincinnati held the upper hand again. Kenny Anderson's 53-yard connection to Bob Trumpy moved the Bengals to the Steeler 20. But 3 plays later, Anderson found Essex Johnson, who lost the handle, regained it, and then lost it again. John Rouser recovered Johnson's fumble as heads-up play by the Steeler defense kept Pittsburgh close, trailing 6-3. The Bengals had fashioned their lead thanks to their own heads-up defense as they continued to bottle up Bradshaw. Finally, the Bengals drove Bradshaw from the game when he suffered a broken collarbone that may well have ended Bradshaw's season. But disposing of Terry may have been the Bengals' fatal flaw. For the third time this season, backup quarterback Terry Hanratty's first pass of the game went for a touchdown. This time to Ron Shanklin. Pittsburgh led at the half 10-6. In the second half, Hanratty continued to move the Steelers well, connecting on his 2nd and 3rd passes of the game to set up a field goal and a 13-6 Pittsburgh lead. But on the drive, Terry number 2 sustained a painful rib injury. And so with the Steeler offense in trouble, their defense went out to get some points. Although punter Dave Lewis got a reasonably good snap, the Steelers were in so fast he couldn't get his punt away and was tackled at his own four. Set up the short Steeler touchdown and a 20-6 Pittsburgh lead. Then the Steeler defense, mainly in the person of safety Mike Wagner, number 23, set out to protect their lead. Three times in the last 20 minutes, Wagner snitched Anderson passes to keep the Bengals off the board. Only once did the Steeler defense falter when Anderson hit Essex Johnson with a 16-yard touchdown pass to make the score Pittsburgh 20, Cincinnati 13. Johnson's touchdown came with 7 minutes left, but the Bengals could not get the tie. Wagner's third interception of the day helped the Steelers successfully avenge their only loss of the season. Pittsburgh's 20-13 victory over Cincinnati gave the Steelers a game and a half pad in their division, a cushion they may need with Terry Hanratty nursing sore ribs and Terry Bradshaw possibly lost for the season.
On a Monday night, the Steelers face the Washington Redskins. They are without Terry Bradshaw and John Cupua, but they are ready. Terry Hanratty shakes off his injury of the previous week, and a fully healthy Franco Harris takes the sting out of the loss of Cupua. Hanratty throws two touchdown passes, and the Steelers lead 14-9. But once again, Steeler joy is shattered. Hanratty re-injures his ribs and is lost for the game. Steeler control begins to slip away, and second-year quarterback Joe Gilliam is on the spot. Gilliam's pass to Barry Pearson appears to be merely frosting on a Pittsburgh victory cake. But it means much more than that, for the Redskins climb to within 5 points. And late in the game, they are perched on the Steelers 17. Mike Wagner's big hit leads to a Glenn Edwards interception, but the game is not over yet. It is fitting that Joe Green finally covers the fickle football. The Steeler big play defense has been nurtured over the past several years by wise drafting. But it has all sprung from the seed that was planted 5 years ago when the Steelers drafted all-pro Joe Green. With a 21-16 victory over Washington and a 7-1 record, the Steelers are off to Oakland. Terry Hanratty is back in action for the Raiders game, and Franco Harris's strong running spurs memories of his last performance against these same Oakland Raiders. Hanratty finds Ron Chanklin, and the Steelers with 17 points have enough to win. It is enough because the Steelers defense tears into the Raider backfield. Defensive ends Dwight White, number 78, and L.C. Greenwood, number 68, lead an inspired Steeler defense to victory. Joe Green crushes Darryl LaMonica, and White intercepts two passes. For the third straight time, Oakland is defeated. The Steelers are 8-1. And members of pro football's ruling class.
Welcome to the genuine grass field of the Oakland Coliseum, where wonders never cease. How often have you seen a punter run from his own end zone, breaking four tackles along the way? Ray Guy now has a lifetime pro rushing average of 21 yards, but he was the reliable part of the Oakland kicking game. The AFC's leading passer, Ken Stabler, could play only the first quarter due to a banged-up knee. And suddenly, the AFC's top-rated offensive machine was missing its main cog. As an older quarterback looked on, the responsibility was passed to quarterback number three, Darryl LaMonica, a younger old quarterback who did manage to stir up some occasional fireworks with his once-renowned arm. Late in the fourth quarter, LaMonica put up Oakland's only touchdown with an old-fashioned bomb to Fred Biletnikoff. The old-fashioned Raider glory was short-lived, however, as for most of the afternoon, LaMonica was entertaining visitors in the Oakland backfield. Number 68, L.C. Greenwood, was one of the most persistent. He even stole poor Darryl's handkerchief. When the left end, Greenwood, was not pestering LaMonica, usually it was the right end who was. Dwight White, number 78. Dwight White was literally all over the field. Watch the right end, number 78. White grabbed two of LaMonica's four interceptions, one of which, as we can see in a replay, was caused by Joe Green, number 75. LaMonica's Pittsburgh counterpart, number 5, Terry Hanratty, didn't have a great day either. But he capitalized on what the defense gave him enough times to make a lot of people in Oakland miserable indeed. And so, two former Notre Dame quarterbacks met in the marshland at Oakland. And this time, number 5 was the winner by a score of 17-9.
The Denver Broncos invade Three Rivers Stadium in Week 10. The game matches the hand-holding Denver defenders against the steel curtain. An emotionally high Bronco defense against a tried and true Pittsburgh defense. The game is a brawl. The Steelers trail until a hand-ready pass nails Ron Chanklin, who runs the Steelers into a 13-13 tie. The Broncos add a field goal to lead 16-13. And so Hanratty begins a go-ahead drive. But the comeback is not to be, as the aroused Broncos strip away a fumble, dooming Pittsburgh's last chance. A Charlie Johnson touchdown pass finishes Pittsburgh 23-13. The same emotional roller coaster that carried the Steelers to a division title in 1972 has picked up the Denver Broncos, who are the first team to defeat the Steelers at Three Rivers Stadium in 14 games.
The groundskeepers at Three Rivers Stadium in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, take special pride in their work, for in this stadium, the phrase home field advantage becomes a harsh reality for visiting teams. The Steelers are unbeaten in the last 13 consecutive regular season games played at Three Rivers. The cream of the NFL has come to play in the stadium, and the Steelers have won, regardless of the quality of those teams or the nature of their personnel. But while bashful, sneezy, dopey, grumpy, and Doc would pose no threat for the Steelers, the team they face today is no Mickey Mouse Club, for they face John Ralston's positive-thinking Denver Broncos, who, like the Steelers, can envision themselves in the playoffs at season's end. Ralston has worked miracles with the Broncos this season. Denver shows a winning record after 9 games for only the second time in their history. But more importantly, they now find themselves just 1/2 game out of first place in the AFC West Division. Today's game provides an interesting matchup of the Broncos offense, the highest scoring team in the AFC, versus the Steelers defense, the second stingiest defense in the conference. Terry Hanratty has taken over the Steelers' offense since number one quarterback Terry Bradshaw was injured 4 weeks ago and has led the Steelers to wins over Cincinnati, Washington, and Oakland. So the Steeler offense has not missed a beat, but if it should, they can always fall back on golden shoes. Several Steeler defensemen have taken to wearing golden shoes in the belief that their defense is pure gold, and indeed it may be. The Steeler rush line has harried enemy quarterbacks into an astounding 25 interceptions in just 9 games. Steel is an even better metallic description of Pittsburgh's defense, but for today's game, one of their girders is missing. The NFL's outstanding defensive performer last season, tackle Joe Green, will not be starting as he has been hampered by back spasms during the week prior to the game. The two teams have met twice before in regular season play, and the Broncos have won both times. But a win for them today is far more important. The Steelers have a comfortable cushion in their conference, but if the Broncos hope to stay alive in theirs, they must have a win today in Pittsburgh. In their interception, Hanratty continued to throw, and the Steelers began to move. A pass to Preston Pearson got the Steelers their initial first down, and from better field position, Hanratty began to air it out. A 22-yard strike to Ron Shanklin carried to the Denver 23, but from there, the Steeler offense was shut down. To make matters worse, the usually reliable Roy Girella missed a 23-yard field goal, and this inability to get the ball across the goal line from in close was to be one of the keys of the first half. But the Broncos weren't having much success moving the ball either, as their first 3 possessions yielded minus 7 yards. Meanwhile, Hanratty was sticking to the bombing run attack, and on the Steelers' second series, he almost hit tight end John McMakin with a long one. McMakin thought he should have had it, but it would have been an unbelievable catch. Still, the play had nearly clicked, and so on the Steelers' next possession, Hanratty tried again. This time, the pass connected for 44 yards, and Franco Harris tanked it 17 more, carrying to the Denver 9-yard line. But for the second time in the first period, the Steelers could move no farther, as the Bronco defense toughened up whenever the Steelers threatened. Once again, Pittsburgh called on Girella's leg. This time he hit to tie the score at 3. But the Steelers had now been close to the goal line on 2 occasions, yet had just a field goal to show for it. On occasion, a couple of Girella field goals are enough to win for the Steelers, for their defense can make almost any lead stand up. Johnson was having no luck running, but when he went to the air, he began to move the Broncos. Though they lead the NFL in interceptions, experts credit the Steelers' front four with forcing many of them and believe that the Steelers' secondary can be cracked open. In the second period, Johnson was moving the Broncos by passing, but this one to Riley Odoms was nullified by a penalty killing the drive, and the rest of the first half would be eaten up on one ball possession drive by each team. On the Steeler drive, Hanratty changed his attack to a ground game. But after getting 2 first downs by the rush, Terry went back to the big play attack. Frank Lewis made a baffling, bobbling catch off Calvin Jones, and the play is even more remarkable when we see a repeat. Hanratty made a good fake to Harris, but was still pressured and was nailed by number 79, Barty Chavis, as he threw. Chavis's rush caused the ball to be underthrown slightly, but Lewis still made the grab. Chavis could only watch downfield and say, "What's the use?" Lewis carried to the Denver 13, but once again, the Steelers could not get into the end zone. The Steelers again had to settle for the field goal. Girella made it, but the Steelers then got a big break. On the play, the Broncos were called for a personal foul, giving Pittsburgh four more cracks, this time from the Denver 5-yard line. But with Ralston beaming positive thoughts to his defense, and his defense doing their hand-holding thing, Pittsburgh was again stopped without a touchdown. The Steelers had had first downs on the Denver 23, 9, 13, and 5-yard lines, and had just two field goals to show for it. On the first series of the fourth quarter, however, Hanratty and the Steeler offense pulled themselves out of their doldrums. Pittsburgh's running attack had gone absolutely no place, so starting from his own 20, Hanratty went to the air. Three passes later, the Steelers had a touchdown. First, Frank Lewis took a bullet for 19 yards. Then Hanratty spiraled another beauty to tight end John McMakin. It was good for 15 yards to the Pittsburgh 43. Two consecutive passes, two first downs. Hanratty was hot, and with good protection, he went over the middle again, this time to Shanklin all alone in the seam of the zone. The foot race wasn't close. Another look at the Steeler touchdown shows Hanratty looking over the defense while backpedaling deep. He briefly looked left, then fired over the middle. The fleet Shanklin was on his way to his ninth touchdown of the season, high in the American Conference. Shanklin is a receiver that doesn't get the publicity he deserves, but while he doesn't catch many passes, he catches the big ones. Pittsburgh had now tied the game again, this time at 13. Pittsburgh's final play was a swing pass to Franco Harris, good for big yardage. But Franco made the Steelers' second straight error when he fumbled the ball away. The opportunistic Broncos again had made the breaks. The result was an upset victory of the powerful Pittsburgh Steelers 23-13. The Denver Broncos are the only team in the National Football League that has never experienced a winning season. John Ralston was brought in from Stanford to change that, and it appears that in his third season he will. Denver is now two games over 500 with a chance for a playoff spot. They have a game apiece remaining with the two toughest contenders in their division, Kansas City and Oakland.
The following week, the Steelers traveled to Cleveland, a wasteland for Pittsburgh teams over the past 8 years. Terry Hanratty completes his first pass of the game, but on the play, he is hurt again. This time it is for good and finishes his season. Joe Gilliam completes the drive with a strike to Ron Shanklin, the sixth straight game in which he has scored and his ninth touchdown catch of the year. Three Roy Girella field goals, a high-pressure pass rush, and hands-up defense have the Steelers ahead late in the game. But a Cleveland-Pittsburgh game in Cleveland is never over until the final gun. Greg Pruitt's touchdown with 1 minute to play appears to wrap up the Browns' ninth straight win over the Steelers in Cleveland. But Joe Gilliam, despite the fact that he's under heavy siege, hangs tough and completes three straight clutch passes. Gilliam gut drives the Steelers to the Cleveland 15, and in the game's dying seconds, goes for it all. The pass is inches too long. The Steelers have lost two straight, and the Browns have, for yet another year, cast a shadow of doubt on a Steeler season.
Cleveland Browns head coach Nick Skorich was quoted as saying, "We have to go to the river. They have to come to the lake." Despite appearances, the lake he referred to, Lake Erie, was outside, not inside Cleveland's Municipal Stadium last Sunday. Skorich was simply underscoring the fact that in this fierce rivalry called the Turnpike Tournament, the home team usually wins. Despite the rabid support of Steeler fans that drive the 90 miles that separates the two cities, Pittsburgh has not won in Cleveland since 1964, eight games ago. Conversely, the Browns have lost four straight at the River, Pittsburgh's Three Rivers Stadium. As is their tradition, the Browns are making their typical late run for the playoffs this year. Cleveland's consistency in winning year after year is one of the more remarkable achievements in sport, considering the feast or famine histories of most NFL franchises. What is unusual is that the Browns are relying not on their offense, but on a vastly improved defensive squad. Ranked number one in their conference most of the year, the heart of the unit is the fine pair of tackles, number 71 Walter Johnson and number 72 Jerry Shirk. The biggest reason for improvement is the acquisition of hometown hero Bob Babich at middle linebacker. He cost Cleveland the number one choice in next year's draft. Then, too, Joe Jones is back in the lineup at defensive end after missing the entire season last year with a knee injury. Turkey's always been a terror on the pass rush, but this season has excelled at playing the run also. The Cleveland defense's finest moment came only last week when they shut out the explosive Oakland Raiders until the final minute of play when a field goal was kicked against them. So Cleveland went into this game with the momentum of their big win over the Raiders. Pittsburgh, on the other hand, was upset by the Denver Broncos the week before. Still, the Steelers hold a 1.5 game lead over the second-place Browns, who have the league's toughest schedule ahead of them, all of them road games. So the scene is set for a battle between two very tough defensive football teams in one of football's bitterest rivalries, the Cleveland Browns versus the Pittsburgh Steelers in the NFL Game of the Week. Pittsburgh had first possession, and starting quarterback Terry Hanratty's first pass was a big one. It was perfectly thrown between three Cleveland defenders to John McMakin, the second-year tight end. Hanratty's first pass turned out to be the last pass of the day for him. Watch his right wrist as he tried to break his fall after being hit by Jerry Shirk. Monday morning x-rays would disclose no fracture, merely a severe sprain of the wrist. Nevertheless, Hanratty, the number two quarterback, like Terry Bradshaw, the number one passer, was out of the game. On his first pass, it was as pretty and successful as Hanratty's had been. Ron Shanklin was the receiver. In two tries, Pittsburgh had burned the Cleveland secondary twice. From the Cleveland 13, Joe Willie Gilly, as he calls himself, with plenty of time to throw, speared Ron Shanklin in front of Clarence Scott in the end zone, and Pittsburgh had a touchdown. Shanklin had two big catches on Scott, Cleveland's best defender, and Pittsburgh's third-string quarterback, Joe Gilliam, had put them in the lead 7-0. pulled off another big play. Reserve tight end Larry Brown, number 87, took the pass 45 yards to the Browns 23. A repeat shows the play from the vantage point of number 29, the strong safety, Walt Sumner. Playing the zone, Sumner had dropped deep and could not recover in time to stop Brown from infiltrating the empty seam in the zone coverage between cornerback Ben Davis, number 28, and himself. But here, Sumner, usually a sure tackler, missed completely, and Brown was on his way toward pay dirt. Only a great effort by Bob Babbage saved the touchdown. Several plays later, number 80, Joe Jones, jumped off sides and ruined Sumner's chance for redemption when he intercepted Gilliam's toss. The Browns' defense did, however, force the Steelers to go for 3 points instead of six, which they got from Roy Girella despite the poor footing. The score at the half was Cleveland 14, Pittsburgh 10. The Steelers' second half game plan was much more basic as Gilliam handed off six straight times to Preston Pearson. On his set of six straight, Pearson gained 59 yards with the big one, a 31-yard carry after Gilliam's diving handoff, which carried to the Cleveland 14-yard line. The Pittsburgh offensive line was opening huge holes in the Cleveland defense, and on Pearson's last carry of the drive, he gained six more yards to bring up a second and four from the 8-yard line. But this was to be the start of the Steelers' offensive frustrations. They could not get the first down. Gilliam tried Franco Harris twice, and on a third and two, Nick Roman and Bob Babbage dropped him for a loss. The Steelers would have to settle for Roy Girella's three-pointer to trail 14-13, but 3 points was better than nothing, as the Steelers would soon find out. He never tires of setting up the offense in super field position, and Mike Wagner's interception did just that on the Cleveland 33. But the Steelers' second drive of the half would end even more dismally than their first. After a pass for first down, Pearson pierced for 8 yards to bring a second and two on the Browns' 10-yard line. Two plays gained but 1 yard, and on fourth and one, Gilliam again wanted Harris. For the second time in the second half, Pittsburgh had been inside the Cleveland 10. They had gotten 3 points on their first drive. On their second, they were shut out. Time in the half, but then they added a third man to their act. L.C. Greenwood pressured Phipps into a high toss that became Phipps to Kelly to James Thomas, and the Steeler rookie carried to the Pittsburgh 44. The Steelers again had great field position, but after moving to the Cleveland 39, got a piece of his arm and forced another interception, this time by John Rouser. Rouser returned the theft to the Cleveland 21. The Steeler defense had now given the ball to the offense on the Pittsburgh 44 and the Cleveland 33, 32, and 21-yard lines. With such great field position, it was only a matter of time before the Steeler offense capitalized, but not in the way they would have liked. They reached a third and one situation on the Cleveland 12, but when Gilliam again tried Harris, middle linebacker Bob Babbage, number 60, plugged the hole, and Harris was again stopped short of the first down. Middle linebacker has long been a sore spot in the Cleveland defense, but when they obtained Babbage this season for a number one draft pick next season, the sore spot was healed. Babbage has become the band-aid that gives the Cleveland rubber band defense its snap. Though they had held the Steelers without the touchdown, they could do nothing about Roy Girella's field goal, and though playing magnificently, the Browns trailed 16-14 with 8 minutes to go. The Steelers were in a blitz. And when Andy Russell, number 34, was cut down, his area was wide open. All that was left was for Gene Hickerson, number 66, to kick out the corner. And when he did, Pruitt was winging. It was fitting that Hickerson would throw the big block, for the 16-year veteran from Ole Miss was playing before the hometown crowd in his last regular season game. His block enabled Pruitt to score with just 75 seconds left, but the game was far from over. For once, the Steelers did not have good field position, but perhaps bad field position was what they had needed all along. First, Gilliam found Ron Shanklin for 34 yards to the Cleveland 47. And with his next pass, he hit Frank Lewis for 19 more to the 28-yard line. For his third consecutive completion, Gilliam went back to Shanklin, and his leaping grab brought the ball to the Cleveland 15. Three consecutive passes, three consecutive completions, three consecutive first downs. With 29 seconds left, the Steelers had reached the 15, and Gilliam then went with his fourth pass of the drive. Frank Lewis had broken by his man, but Gilliam's pass was inches too long. Three more passes followed, but none was even close. And Lewis lay in the end zone, symbolizing the frustration that the entire Steeler team was feeling, as the inability to score, when presented the opportunities, led to Pittsburgh's downfall, a 21-16 loss to the Browns. When it was over, Cleveland players and fans mobbed their tiny hero, Greg Pruitt. His touchdown was the margin of victory for Cleveland, a victory that brought the Browns to within just a half game of the Steelers in the AFC Central Division. In 2 weeks, the Browns had made up two full games on the Steelers.
The next week, the Steeler quarterback carousel changes once more. Bradshaw is back from his broken collarbone. Hanratty is gone with a broken wrist, and Joe Gilliam is a starting quarterback for the first time in his career. But Gilliam's first start is one that he would sooner forget. Bradshaw replaces Gilliam, but 5 weeks of inactivity cause a repeat performance. The Steelers are embarrassed, 30-3 at halftime. And the fiber of this earlier invincible team is in doubt. To be sure, the Steeler defense could not be faulted. And led by Henry Davis, number 53, Miami gets just one first down in the second half. The Steeler defense lays a second half comeback path, and the Pittsburgh offense marches over it. Franco Harris rushes for over 100 yards, and Bradshaw throws two touchdown passes. The Steelers climb to within 6 points, and Bobby Walden is called on to punt. Walden hits a perfect coffin corner kick, the defense holds, and Miami is forced to take an intentional safety to escape the marauding Pittsburgh Steelers. Now there is precious little time left, and it finally runs out on the Steeler gallant comeback. But in it, the Steelers prove the character of the team. The second half domination of the Super Bowl champions marks a return to normalcy for the Steelers and is the key to their drive to the playoffs. that the Steelers are again a total team. Jack Ham scores for the defense, and Dennis Myatt returns a punt all the way for a special team score. Myatt's score is nullified by a penalty, but it hardly matters as Bradshaw is now completely recovered and hones in on his receiver. Pittsburgh wins 33-7. They are the early season Steelers again and ready to claim their spot in postseason play.
It was one of those days, rainy, slippery, and full of mistakes and penalties for both Houston and Pittsburgh. The ball took on the aspects of a greased watermelon seed for much of the afternoon. In addition to the fumbles, there were four touchdowns called back, including this one, which was one of three for the Steelers. The last Steeler score, which didn't count, was this punt return by number 41, Dennis Meyer. Dennis registered his disappointment much the same way he would have had the score been good. As an addendum to all the mistakes, Terry Bradshaw was welcomed back from injury and welcomed rudely by Houston's Joe Blahock, number 27, who had the longest of the day's eight interceptions. Blahock's grab and go for 87 yards set up a Houston lead, which came on an 11-yard Dante Pastorini to number 82, Mac Alston, hookup. Bradshaw suffered even more rudeness a little later on, and the Houston Oilers looked like they may have had upset in mind. But then the lights went out, the steel curtain descended, and Dante returned to purgatory. Finally finding the range, Terry zipped the go-ahead score to number 83, Barry Pearson, and the Steelers led 10-7. The lead grew on a 3-yard pass from Bradshaw to Steve Davis, which, when added to four Roy Girella field goals, made things dismal for Houston. Dante Pastorini's descent into the seventh circle became complete when he fumbled and Jack Ham recovered for the Steelers to finalize a 33-7 run.
The Steelers arrive in San Francisco on the season's last weekend. And in this second consecutive pressure game, the Steelers blow out the 49ers 37-14. There can be no doubt that this Steeler team, so impressive early in the season, and then challenged by 3 weeks of heartbreaking defeat and the loss of several key players, has returned to its overpowering form and successfully spanned the season. '73 was the most demanding year in Steeler history. For the first time in 40 years, they entered a new season as winners. A poor showing after such a remarkable 1972 season would have quickly returned a loser's label to the Pittsburgh Steelers. But 40 men, unaccustomed as they were to the heady atmosphere of winning, challenged a new season and continued their newfound success. In the season's final week, the Steelers win their 10th game of the year, and storm into the playoffs for the second straight season.
In his final appearance as a 49er, John Brody received the starting nod from head coach Dick Nolan. Now 38 years old, the former most valuable player was suffering from an ailing arm, which forced him to work the short routes early against the Steelers. However, Brody's arm betrayed him twice in the first half, as two interceptions halted promising drives while giving Pittsburgh the early lead. The interception and return of 71 yards for a touchdown by number 48, John Rouser, lifted the Steelers to a 7-0 advantage. But the 49ers matched the score as Wyndon Hall blocked a punt, recovering it for the tie. After Brody removed himself from the game, San Francisco quarterbacks fell victim to the wild fury of number 68, L.C. Greenwood. Watch Greenwood combine with number 78, Dwight White, to drop Steve Spurrier as Pittsburgh all but stopped the 49er offense cold. Offensively, Terry Bradshaw hit on 8 passes for 135 yards as the Steelers moved to 3 short touchdowns and 3 Roy Girella field goals. Bradshaw's only touchdown pass came on a perfect strike of 50 yards to Frank Lewis, who beat Bruce Taylor on the post. Pittsburgh wound up winning big, 37-14 over the San Francisco 49ers.
The arrow points to Oakland, California, and the sign says World Champs, but last week the only bona fide world champions in Oakland were the A's, a baseball team, and the Pittsburgh Steelers of the NFL had traveled the width of this nation with one idea: to make sure that the people of Oakland, in a single year, would not be able to lay grandiose claim to the title of world champion in both of America's most honored sports. For the Pittsburgh Steelers, the journey had been much lengthier than just across the country. For almost 4 decades, the Steelers had lain as doormats before NFL powerhouses until last year, when the men of steel had shed their mild-mannered Clark Kent ways and climbed over the Oakland Raiders into the American Conference Championship game. And now, for the second year in a row, the Pittsburgh Steelers had earned the right to vie for all the honor in the pro football world. And for the second year in a row, the Steelers' first challenge in the Super Series would be the Oakland Raiders. If Oakland fans appeared to be blowing their own horn prematurely, their pride was understandable. For in 6 of the past 7 seasons, the Silver and Black had earned a berth in the playoffs. But though the attitude of the Raiders and their fans seemed to be one of confidence, there must have been some doubts. For while the Raiders were Western Division champions, the Steelers, as the wild card team in the playoffs, actually had the better record for 1973, and Pittsburgh had defeated Oakland in each of their past 3 meetings. Steelers moving late in the period when he hit Dave Williams with his 14-yard gain into Oakland territory. But 2 plays later, number 60, Otis Sistrunk, deflected this Bradshaw aerial and Oakland's Phil Villapiano caught it on the carom to end the Steelers' advance. Beginning the second quarter, Kenny Stabler dumped this pass to Mike Cianni for a 21-yard gain to the Pittsburgh 35-yard line. But the Oakland offensive ended when Kenny Stabler was trapped for a 10-yard loss and the Raiders had to settle for a 10-0 edge after a 25-yard field goal by George Blanda. Having been held in check for more than 25 minutes, Terry Bradshaw finally got the Pittsburgh attack in gear with this good throw for 24 yards to Preston Pearson. Aided by a roughing penalty, Pittsburgh penetrated the Raiders' 10, and then Bradshaw hit Barry Pearson with this pass, putting the Steelers on the board with 2 minutes remaining in the first half. A repeat shows that Pearson appears to be guided out of bounds shy of the end zone, but the official ruled that he did break that imaginary pane of glass. The Raiders' lead was narrowed to 10-7, wiping out the significance of most of Oakland's first half heroics. Although the Raiders were the dominant team for most of the first 30 minutes, rolling up 10 first downs to Pittsburgh's 5 and rushing for 105 yards while holding the Steelers to a mere 34 net yards on the ground, the Silver and Black had relatively little to show for their efforts on the scoreboard, stubbornly tightened up their pucker straps and began to move the football for all the glory it would bring. Using number 33, Frenchie Fuqua, primarily, the Steelers began to slice away sizable gains, showing the class that carried them through the difficult season and into the playoffs. At length, faced with 3rd and 25 at the Raiders' 26, Bradshaw stepped out of the pocket and found Frank Lewis with position on George Atkinson. Lewis's catch made the score Oakland 26, Pittsburgh 14 with 9:05 remaining. But whatever thoughts the Steelers might have had of a miracle finish were soon put to rest. With Marv Hubbard doing most of the work, the Raiders ended the day the way they began it, blowing the mighty Steel Curtain defenders right off the line of scrimmage. As the Steelers coach Chuck Noll was to say later, Willie Brown's interception was the key play, but no one play ever beats you. They beat hell out of us all day on every play. They blew us out. With 35 seconds remaining, Marv Hubbard gained his 91st yard for the day, smashing over to give Oakland a very satisfying 33-14 victory over the Pittsburgh Steelers, keeping alive the grandiose dream in Oakland of double, dynastic domination in professional football and Major League Baseball. But this was a day for the Silver and Black, a day struck with pride and poise, like the California sunset, which served only to remind the Oakland Raiders of their upcoming date in Miami.
For the fourth time in two seasons, the Steelers face the Oakland Raiders, but this time with a different result. They lose to the Raiders, but just as one winning season could not establish a new era of glory, neither can one loss dampen a glorious year. With 10 wins and a playoff berth, the Pittsburgh Steelers are winners again. They have worn their crown well during a challenging season, their first as defending champions.